wherever you may be around the world. And thank you for joining us once again on truth2u.org. That's truth number two, letter U.org. I'm Jono, and joining me is Mr. Spiritual Babies. G'day, Mr. Spiritual Babies.
Well, good evening, Jono. It's nearly midnight here, but I'm excited to be on this show. It's going to be fun.
Are you really? Listen, tell me, before we even dive into it, you like the little pun that I threw in there? Listen, have you ever been scuba diving?
You know what? One time I did in New Zealand. It was amazing.
In New Zealand?
Yeah, yeah.
You liked?
Yeah, it was really cool and terrifying at the same time, but it was great.
Terrifying? Did you come across any sharks or any scary creatures?
Well, you know, when you're way under the ground and there's like you got an air canister on your back and you don't know which way is up, everything is scary. But it was
safe. You're doing your scuba diving under the ground?
Oh yeah, way under the ground.
You meant to be doing it in the water.
That was my
first
mistake.
What's going on in New Zealand? I don't know.
And like I said, it's late.
Okay, listen. I've never been scuba diving. Lately I've been doing a whole lot of swimming to try and get my fitness levels up because, of course, we're going on the tour, the Israel from the Ground Up tour in March. People can go to the website. You'll see a picture of Keith and myself on the right. You can click on that and get the details because there are still seats available. But I've never been, and I like swimming, but I've never actually been scuba diving. But you're going to love this program, Mr. Spiritual Babies, because our guest today is he's from New York. He is a certified dive master and a certified rescue diver with 15 years experience in diving. My goodness. He also happens to be a world-renowned speaker, public speaker, conducting lectures and seminars around the globe. His website is www.outreachjudaism.org. That's outreachjudaism.org, where you will find his ever so challenging and in-depth Bible study entitled Let's Get Biblical: Why Doesn't Judaism Accept the Christian Messiah? It's available in audio and DVD. It has a hardcover study guide, and there's a whole lot of other valuable resources there as well. He's currently working on his latest book entitled In Search of Leviathan. Welcome to the program, Judaism's real-life scuba Steve, Rabbi Tuvia Singer.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate that. It's great to be on.
It's great to have you on.
All those titles, you can just call me King of the Jews and that's enough. You don't know. I think it was a little elaborate. You know, you could just...
Come on, it's not elaborate. I think you know.
Actually, I just offended like half of Europe. I'm sorry. I just it'll be like a crusade, you know, as I said that. All right.
Now listen, you should be doing what I want to say. I mean, I know you're not really working you should be working on a book entitled In Search of Leviathan, because, and it's going to be a coffee book. It's going to be full of beautiful pictures. People are going to buy it. I don't have to buy it because I suggested it to you and you're going to send me a free copy, but you should do that. Yeah. Why don't you do that?
You know, it's Jews like you that give us guys a bad name. I just want you to know that. Because really my life is, you know, devoted to teaching Tanakh. I mean, why don't I do that? Because, you know, I love diving. And that's the only thing I do outside of teaching scripture. But there are so much better photographers under the water than myself.
Oh,
so I'm not being humble. I'm not being humble. I'm just, I have, you know, knowledge of diving, many years doing that, and I know a lot about photography, all the dynamics and so on. But there are people there out there who are just artistically, they're just very gifted. What I do, whether it's scripture or under the water, is I can identify something beautiful when I see it. I need to see the real thing. So when I see something magnificent, whether it's Isaiah and Second Chronicles coming together like a symphony, that harmony, or whether it's seeing how God's creatures interact with each other and how each one has a defense and Hashem put such wisdom in it, I just get blown away and pow. So what I do, I might have an artistic skill that I haven't identified. You ask me to draw a man, it'll be a circle with a stick. But the underwater photography means that I see something magnificent and then I want to share with everyone. The same thing about Isaiah. When I read the passages from the sacred timeless work, I want everyone to know about it. I want them to, and that's what I teach on. I teach with this Jeremiah. That's what gives me everything, the reason to live. That's the harmony, the music of the life. And I just transmit it. I plagiarize everything. I just teach what I see.
Well, I want to try and bring both of these things together. Psalm 104, verses 24 to 26, it says, O Lord, how manifold are your works! In wisdom, you have made them all. The earth is full of your possessions. This great and wide sea, in which innumerable teeming things, living things, both small and great, there the ships sail about. There is that Leviathan, which you made to play there. Have you ever come across Leviathan yet?
No, we're not exactly certain the identity of that. That chapter soars because it, of course, speaks about echoes of God's being the creator and the provider. And Yoiducha Hashem Kol Maasecha, all your works praise Him. I have, so in terms of this great, the largest animal in the world, period, we don't have to modify that, is a whale, a blue whale, which is enormous. I've not seen one. I've seen the largest fish in the world, and that's, I've dived with whale sharks. But the key is that for me, when I'm diving, I'm praying to God, I'm praising Him. I don't mean that I see it, I study what I'm looking at, and then I know that Hashem is fingerprints. I could see the wisdom of Hashem in the underwater. But what do you see above water? Like dog, a cat, and a cockroach. So I say cockroach. I only meant fire. I don't know. I have no idea. I was like, what do you see, really? A fly? So there's no diversity. There's no biodiversity. Under the water, there are more fish in the world. There are more marine animals in the world than all reptiles and mammals combined. So it explodes with information.
And the spectacular colors as well. I mean, now, Mr. Spiritual Babies, when you went scuba diving in New Zealand, was it just part of a tour that you were on, or was it something that you put your hand up to go and do? What made you decide to dive?
Actually, the opportunity just came up, and it happened that some of the people in the hostel where I was doing a course, and they happened to know the dive instructor very well. They're actually very strict rules governing how soon you can get in the water and what you can do in the water, and then that was sped up a little bit while I was there, and I think I spent one afternoon in front of a whiteboard with a projector, and by the next day we were diving, which was a little bit soon, I think, possibly.
Oh, well, so the preparation is quite in depth. So have you ever been tempted to return to the water?
You know, I have, but here in Ireland, it's not much to look at.
I was going to say that. Like, what is he going to do? He might as well dive in his bathtub.
We've got some lovely shopping trolleys and old bicycles. If you want to see a really good old bicycle, this is the place to come.
Yeah, that's like saying I want to dive in Brooklyn. It doesn't work. You know what I'm saying? The diving is, but you can get yourself from Ireland to either the Red Sea. Wow, pow, wow, you know, or Australia, where diving is amazing, but Europe really doesn't have any diving to speak of.
Now, you were making noises about coming to Australia and doing some diving. Have you still got that in the...
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I don't know. The only thing is, never sure what time it is in Australia. What day is in Australia? It's 3 weeks from now.
I'm in the future.
I have to go down there, really, to straighten the place up. No, it's in the next couple of months, I'm definitely going to make my way. I please God, I'll make my way to Australia. And I just have to figure out, because the Great Barrier Reef is so enormous that I need to figure out what are the optimum, places to plunge, to film, to photograph, to share.
Yeah.
I can't wait.
Now, listen, before we talk about some of those things, because I do want to come back to that, what inspired you to take up scuba diving? When was the first time that you got in the water, and how did that come about?
You're asking a brilliant question. When I was a kid, I was...
Because I'm brilliant!
Probably, yeah. This is a very good question you pulled out there. I can't get over. So, by the way, I hope my British accent doesn't throw off your audio. When I was a kid, I was absolutely petrified to go in the water. My mother, these are like the earliest memories I have. My mother used to take me to Brighton Beach, Brooklyn, okay? And take me in the water, and the waves would come, and she'd like pull me down as the waves came. I basically thought my mother was trying to kill me. It's ugly, nasty water. You can't see anything. So I was absolutely all my life petrified of putting a toe in the water, thinking for sure. When I saw Jaws, it just made so much sense to me. It confirmed every fear that I ever had. Now, what I was lecturing in the Bahamas, I was speaking at the Atlantis Hotel on Paradise Island, and to Jewish funeral directors gathering. I was a keynote speaker. And after the lecture, there were no flights after the lecture, so I had the afternoon. I went jet skiing in the water, And then I stopped the jet ski and looked down, and I just, it blew my mind away. I saw everything. It was the glass. I could see the fish, the colors exploding, and I saw that it was safe. That means I could see what was around me. It wasn't, and at that moment, I decided not to swim in the water, not to snorkel, but I wanted to dive. And it was just a few weeks later that I was a diver. I was certified, and I still, to this day, I have no interest in swimming or snorkeling. I only want to be beneath the surface.
Right. Wow. So where are some of your favorite dive locations? Where are some of the favorite places you have been?
Well, the Red Sea is astonishing. The Red Sea is the highest salt content of any sea in any body of water in the world. The diversity, it's about biodiversity. Don't come to the Caribbean. There's only 300-400 species. In the Red Sea, you're talking about maybe 1,500 species. The colors are mind-blowing. The visibility is outrageous because of the salt makes it impossible for the algae and other organic growth to take place. So that's Indonesia has the largest biodiverse, as the most biodiverse place on Earth. And diving with maybe 2,000 species is absolutely mind-blowing. So that, but the Red Sea is very accessible. It's very inexpensive. It's fascinating. Some of it's very biblical. There's some fascinating discoveries in the Red Sea. And it's wall diving. It's powerful. And if you want the big pelagics, if you want to dive with the large sharks, that's where you go.
Oh, I can't believe that. Some of the photos, I'm going to come back to the sharks, because some of the photos that I've seen, I'm very concerned for you. But you are a certified rescue diver, correct?
Yes.
Dare I say that you are quite literally then a fisher of men?
Yes. Yes, I am.
That's fair enough, isn't it?
I came up with it, and they stole it from me. They took that whole thing from me. That whole
piece. You should have copyrighted that.
You should have done that.
I have a Jewish lawyer. I'm working it through.
Okay. Have you ever been in a situation?
I have had to rescue anyone in my life. It's just
you haven't.
Being a master scuba diver, you train. You train hard. I have never. Diving is very, very safe in that. When you go swimming and you're out there in the ocean, you're relying on your own, obviously on Hashem, but you are relying ostensibly on your own strength, your ability, your requisite skills and strength. When you're diving, you can't drown. You can't drown. You can't you can't get in trouble. You're just because no matter what, you could float to the top. Your body is completely covered, so nasty organic material can't touch you. That's the easiest way to be in the water. That's the safest way to be in the water. Every day in the United States, 10 people drown every single day, but maybe 2 people a year get killed by a shark. So we're talking about, you hear drownings all the time. Scuba divers.
Yeah, you hear drownings all the time. But here in Australia, I mean, we're an island. We're covered by coast, and just a few days ago, very sadly, a 19-year-old young man was attacked by a shark and died on the New South Wales northern coast, I believe. And it's not unusual to hear about occurrences such as this in the media. And as you said, you saw the movie Jaws, and you were absolutely petrified of sharks. I see photos of you swimming around, and as you're almost wearing them. It's like, you know, it's a bit cold outside. I think I'll throw on a shark. And there you are with sharks all around you. How do you do that? I mean, that freaks me out.
I've hung on to the dorsal fins and moved with them.
What, like dolphins? What are you talking
about? No, we're talking about sharks.
I know, but I mean, I've seen people do that with dolphins. Like,
no, you can do it with the shark as well. Not every shark, but the big boys you can do that with. The point, we don't now understand it is frowned upon to touch marine life when you're diving. But you get so close, you just have to just hang on. You got to feel, you got to sense it. The problem, what would happen, Rahman al-Khan, heaven, but what happened, this terrible tragedy, is it's going to happen to surfers and people on a boogie board. What happens is that at the surface, part of your body or part of this structure is submerged and part of it is outside the water. It creates a refraction of light. And that refraction, whether it's a shark or a person, distorts what the shark sees. And therefore, it's a case of mistaken identity. So whereas a diver is below the surface, that means our entire body is completely seen by the shark. Sharks generally don't have the best vision, but they certainly could see. They use other electromagnetic ways of sensing it, but what they see is a person. And Hashem programmed the shark. I mean, it's not like a cat or a dog, good mood, bad mood, a mammal that's not a, doesn't have mammalian feelings. It doesn't. So a shark is programmed, hardwired. It sees a human. It has no idea what it's looking at. It's, you're not a part of its world. It will not. It will not. You have to do something really stupid to get bitten by a shark. But the case of a diver getting bitten by a shark is maybe once in 15 years. It just doesn't happen because the shark recognizes you. Oh, doesn't recognize you.
Are they curious? When you're under the water, does the marine life react to you in the way that you react to it, or do they just get on with their day?
They appear to be completely ambivalent to your existence, and the key is that diving is to use as little energy as possible to breathe slow. They don't like the bubbles. They don't appreciate your presence, but they're otherworldly. So you have to be very, very still in order to allow the fish to do whatever they do so you can observe them. The exception, of course, is a dolphin. When you're diving and suddenly you hear them, water is 26 times more dense than the air. So sound travels very quickly. And the audios just blow all over the place. And you hear the whistles and the clicks, and then you start to feel the chills because you know it's coming. And so you hear the dolphins, and then bang, they're there. Dolphins, a dog has the intelligence of about a 3-year-old, cat an 18-month-year-old. Dolphin has the intelligence of somewhere around a 7 or 8-year-old to a completely thinking creature.
Really?
So, yes. So when you encounter, this is, we could do shows on dolphins. These are completely intelligent animals. I can only tell you the sense that any person who's listening to the show who's encountered dolphins in the wild, forget what you see, in the wild is they know, I can just say the sense is very clear. They know you're of the same as them, meaning they look into your eyes. You can play ball with them underwater. They know that you have a thinking brain. Not fish do have brains, but they're very different orientation. And you could completely interact with them. Again, they're very, very, very intelligent animals.
So there's a natural connection there, is what you're saying.
Oh, yeah, completely. The only thing is that, you know, animals and us, we have a lot in common. I see a dog looking to get to eat, to mate, to sleep. I get that. I get that whole picture. Because we, like animals, are made from the dust of the earth. The difference is, of course, that Hashem, the master of the universe, blew his breath, his divine spark of life, into us. And therefore, we have the tension that dolphins and other creatures don't. We stand upright, vertical, because there's the part of us that faces heaven. And then there's the animal in us, and that's the tension that we have. Dolphins have no free will, but they exhibit God's master and wonder. I couldn't even begin to talk about it. But we are made up of both the divine spirit of God and the animal, and that's the tension, and hence the free will.
Wow. So I'd like to read, if I may, another scripture, Bereshit chapter 1, verses 20 to 22. In it, it says, "Then God said, let the waters abound with an abundance of living creatures. So God created great sea creatures and every living thing that moves, which with the waters abounded according to that kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters in the seas." Now, very few of us, Tobia, get to see this abundance of living creatures. But it just so happens that you're a very keen underwater photographer. You mentioned that you wanted to come to Australia. I'm looking at a photo of yours at the moment, and I found Nemo.
Oh, the clownfish.
The clownfish, and there he is. You found Nemo. You took a photo of him, and here he is. Tell us about the clownfish.
Exploding with color. You only find that in tropical waters. They live all their lives in what's called an enemy. It looks like fingers, and you'll see that orange. They're different colors. They're actually a little bit toxic, which means that The clownfish is a very beautiful creature. Photographers love them because obviously they explode with color. The enemy that they live in are just color everything. It looks like it was really made by Disney. But that enemy is really toxic, and the fish really are not good swimmers. They spend their entire life living in that, and because they were born in that enemy, they are completely they're completely safe from its toxins. That means only they can go into that environment and not be injured because they were born in it. And they live their entire lives in it or around it and never leave. And they live as couples. And you always see them together. And then that's where they breed. So it's again Sachem's wonders. I mean, it's gorgeous to, as a photographer. It's wow. But what happens is you study and you say, wow, so this animal cannot fish quickly. I mean, swim quickly. It therefore must have, what did Hashem do to protect it? Because it has to have, it's like a chess game. You have one, a weakness and a strength. Everything has that. And they live in this environment that only they could be in. To anything else, it's toxic. Now, when I use the word toxic, you will not die if you touch it. It just would be very unpleasant to the skin. But no fish would ever want to go there. So they live their lives in there, and the photography is outrageous.
Oh, it's amazing. And some of these photos, all of these photos are just incredible. Mr. Spiritual Babies, what are some of your favorite photos that we're looking at here?
Well, to be honest, I love the fish, but some of the, like the shrimp is amazing. That banded coral shrimp just... Yeah. It's like a firework under the water.
Yeah.
And a lot of people might get upset. They'll be like, a shrimp, you know, that shellfish, you shouldn't be looking at shellfish, it's unclean. But it's ridiculous.
You shouldn't be eating it.
You shouldn't be eating it. Yeah, but it's a beautiful animal. Why can't you enjoy a beautiful animal? Yeah.
He looks hairy, right? I mean, is he hairy? I mean, what's that about?
I got to tell you the story of the shrimp. The shrimp was shot in a place called Bonaire. Bonaire is a very tiny island, probably the best island in the Caribbean, about 75 miles north of South Venezuela. The shrimp was underneath the coral. I photographed that literally upside down, vertically, but up head down, and because it's underneath in a cave, in a sort of underneath the coral. So I couldn't get the angle. So I'm standing completely upside down, and it's kind of darkened, so I have my camera lights on the side, big lights, and I saw it, but I always, with these photographs, after I look at them on the big screen, I see much more than I would see, especially with the tiny little creature like that. So that was shot, I'm upside down, obviously I flipped the picture around, but that was shot upside down in Bonaire. I remember the second, I remember the moment that I banged it out, and it's brilliant, it's absolutely brilliant. It's true, Leviticus 11, we're not allowed to eat them, but looking at them is marvelous.
Amen. I mean, so now I'm looking at a, I think this is a frogfish. He looks like he went through the windscreen. It's, doesn't he?
Frogfish is a non-migratory predator. It's one of those fish that don't move. He basically can't really move. It looks like it was built by a committee. It is hard to see when you're diving. You need to know what to look for. They camouflage themselves. Those photographs, I don't tamper with the frogfish, but I do remove a little of the saturation of the background, because if I didn't, you wouldn't even be able to see it in the picture. The frogfish basically don't move. They also have a toxin on their skin because they can't swim away from predators. And they have on their nose coming up a little thing that wiggles around and looks like a worm. It's actually part of the frogfish. And they sit there and they wait. And they swirl this worm around that comes off the top of its nose. Along comes some unsuspecting little fish and bang. And I don't know if you see the picture with the frogfish eating. It's one after the other. I had to wait 20 minutes for that. And its mouth explodes open, double in size to the actual body of the animal. You have to wait there and just clap. Bang it.
That's the photo that you've taken of the yellow one there, right?
Right, the yellow one. So you have two sides. I sat there in Bonaire waiting until finally a fish came and the mouth explodes. It is the fastest moving reflex in the entire animal kingdom. It shoots out like a gun. It's so fast.
Wow. It's
fishing itself, right? The little thing that's hanging off its nose is a little lure.
Yes. Right. It has the lure. It looks just like a worm, but it's part of the frogfish. It sits there very camouflaged. And then when a fish comes by going for the worm, its mouth explodes. And when I say explodes, you imagine like a cannon. It just explodes and then sucks in the fish. It doesn't really have teeth. It just sucks it in. Just sit there and just go, am I dreaming?
I'm glad it's equipped with all of that special gear, because as animals go, it's not the prettiest. You know, I'd much rather
be an ugly
super killer than a really pretty dinner for somebody.
No, this is not gefilte fish. This is absolutely gorgeous animals.
There's a bright yellow eel. What kind of eel is this?
a bright yellow greenish eel, isn't it?
Greenish eel, yeah.
Yeah, it's a moray eel. That was shot in the Grand Cayman Islands. Now, those shots wouldn't be possible any place in the world. It's not that eels are not poisonous, but you certainly don't want to mess with their mouth. They open their mouth constantly and close them, not because they're biting, but because that's how they breathe. They have to move the water through the gills in order to breathe, so they're opening and closing. But in Grand Cayman, there's some place called Stingray City, and there are these two eels that have been so comfortable around humans that they just come out looking for handouts, and we just feed them as they come by. I know it sounds very weird, never touch an eel underwater, but these two eels are completely acclimated to human beings. Their skin feels very nice. I mean, it feels like velvet. It's something really, really nice. And they come by and just open your hand very wide open. You don't want them to take your finger. And just if you have a piece of fish in your hand, they just eat it out and they stick around. But that cannot be done anywhere else in the world that I'm aware of. And you could photograph things there. In the wild, they're hidden in a cave. They're hidden in a little crevice. They're not interested in you. And you just, but that's there, they completely interact.
So now I'm looking at do I pronounce this? Is this a grouper?
Yeah, grouper.
What is going on there? Speaking of teeth, wow, he's enormous.
Yeah, he's a big boy. The largest group in the world, I'm proud to say, is called the Jewfish. I didn't make that up. That isn't a Jewfish, but there is a Jewfish. Go ahead, Google it. It's there. Everyone's going, I don't believe that. There isn't a Jewfish. Well, there is. A Jewfish is the largest group, but they weigh up to 700 pounds. And we, I think, as large as 5 or 6 feet, like 2 meters. They're like a Volkswagen. I'm just enormous. It's just that, but just bigger, bigger, bigger. There's a funny spin on the... Now, why they call it a Jewfish, I don't know. Ask a Gentile. I have no idea. But are there any Gentiles here? All right. So, but what happened was, the story goes on, is that apparently the Anti-Defamation League didn't like that they called this huge grouper, because the groupers have these humongous lips. I mean, because they suck in whatever. Anyways, they're big lips. I mean, huge.
Yeah, they do.
The whole thing is just wild. It's just wild. So the grouper has lips. I mean, you have to look on YouTube or something to get what I'm saying. So there was all this people saying, you know, that's really not nice to call it a Jewfish. I don't know which Nazi called it a Jewfish, but I don't think they meant anything bad. So they actually then changed the name to a Nassau grouper in order to not offend the Jews. So it's either called a Jewfish, but what you're seeing there, I think, is a marbled grouper. So that's maybe a couple of feet long. But it is a very striking animal. Huge, just huge features. Easy to photograph because they're in cleaning stations frequently. They're sitting there being cleaned by other fish. So they'll just let you bang your shot away.
What do you mean they're sitting there being cleaned by other fish? What there's little car washes?
Everybody feeds everybody. It's symbiosis. What happens is that sharks will sit there in special cleaning stations. They have parasites that gather on their skin. And therefore, they will allow fish they would normally eat to come and literally clean out their teeth, clean out their mouths, go inside their gills, and won't close them, because the animal that's eating it is gaining the nutrition from eating this bacteria, this material on the fish. The turtles need to be cleaned. So you all have to go into a cleaning station. And then fish that these animals would normally eat will not touch them because they need to be cleaned. So that's called symbiosis. Two animals working together. One is benefiting. Each one is benefiting in their own way. So the same thing with the group.
Awesome.
They need to be cleaned. It's so unbelievable. Just mind-blowing. Mind-blowing.
It's incredible.
So I've seen in the shopping centers now, in the shopping malls, you can go in and sit in on a chair, and they'll put your feet in this pool of water, and they have these little fish that come.
Oh, I've seen that.
Right.
I saw it actually at Engedi. There was they had a facility like that. You could put your feet in a pool of water with these fish that would come and eat your feet. So why would you want to do that?
Well, it's good enough for the sharks.
But he's someone's feet blood with fish. Why do we need a restaurant? We don't need a kitchen. Just get someone to put the water in charge of someone. That's so ridiculous. I see. That's what I wouldn't be comfortable with. I like diving because I want to be in control. I like my body's completely covered by neoprene. I want to touch them, but on my terms. I don't want a clownfish flying through my nose.
While you've been scuba diving, have you ever had a fish come up to you and say, "Hey, I just want to clean that bit, just right there. I just want to clean that on you. Is that okay? I'm just going to clean this."
Yeah, there are fish that will. They're in the Red Sea. I am going to look very carefully, and I'm going to, please God, if I find this image, which you won't believe when I put it up there, of a diver I'm with, who a fish that's a cleaner came and went in his ear just a little bit, just like a Q-tip, just went in his ear a little bit and started cleaning inside of his ear. And I know this sounds, and you're like, right, you're making this one up. I'm not. This happened in Sharm el-Sheikh, which is the lowest point of the Sinai Peninsula, and I grabbed the shot of this guy with the fish partially in. Now, don't get scared, everybody. You're going to go down with earmuffs. This is a, it just happens to be he was in that place and that happened. But this, that does happen with the cleaning fish want to clean. But you're covered. I don't like, I wouldn't go down without being covered because I know what kind of organic material is in there.
Wow. So listen, we've got here in Australia, we have, particularly up in the north, the box jellyfish, which is one of, if not the most poisonous jellyfish, I think, in the world. And I know it has something incredible, like 24 eyes or something like that. I'm looking at a picture that you took of a jellyfish. What, do you know what kind of jellyfish this is?
No.
But it's a jellyfish, everyone. And it looks great. Come on, tell us something about jellyfish in general.
It's a Hasidic Lubavitcher. I have no idea. I'm in Sharm and diving in the Sinai Peninsula, and I'm 15 feet below the surface, because that's called a safety stop. Before you come up, you wait for 3 minutes at 15 feet. So you just hang out. You just stay there to work off all the nitrogen. And as I'm there, bingo, I see this beautiful jellyfish with all its splendor and colors. Naturally, I pick up my camera and pound, get the shot, get that great shot. Jellyfish, that's another thing about diving is that these jellyfish, which you cannot think, are sort of carried by the water and have tentacles down. Some of them are poisonous. Their tentacles cannot penetrate your neoprene suit. This is another reason to stop with the swimming and with the snorkeling and get a wetsuit on. Again, your body is completely covered. It's not something you encounter very much, but it's true. The boxfish, I think, is the most possibly either that or the blue-ringed octopus, also in your backyard, most poisonous creatures in the world.
Yeah, that's so true. Touching a blue ring octopus will kill you in a very short amount of time, is my understanding.
You have basically 2 minutes.
Why is this? We've got the most poisonous snake. We've got the most poisonous octopus. The most poisonous jellyfish. We've got the most poisonous spider.
but these are not.
It's not fair that we should have the most poisonous of everything in one country.
Who told you to go to the other side of the world? You should be on the next side.
I don't know if they. They didn't have much choice.
I mean, at least in Ireland, they had St. Patrick who took all the snakes out.
Oh, yeah, he got rid of all the snakes and all the rhinos, and we don't have any unicorn problems either.
Well, there you go. But we've got the funnel web spider and the brown snake and all of this stuff. I don't know. I think we can go anyway.
So I'm looking at a picture here of a leopard. It's titled Leopard. Is that a fish or a cuttlefish? Or beautiful little yellow spots on, and it's kind of an... Looks like a painted egg. It's amazing.
Painted egg. Oh, it's hanging on a branch.
Right, yeah.
Yes, that's called a leopard. This is a heck of a time on air to do this. It's a snail. And you have to look carefully on the sponge, and they hang on to it. It is, wow. Shot that in Key Largo, Florida. And it may be called a leopard something, whatever. The shell is exquisite. The colors are exquisite. The photographing them is outrageous. That's a brilliant animal. You have to look carefully at the sponge and the sea fans to notice them. They are brilliant. The name escapes me, but that's a beautiful.
You did mention the cuttlefish. Now, the cuttlefish is something that I am fascinated with. I mean, usually when you're walking along the beach, you'll pick up a cuttlefish shell, and give it to the budgie to sharpen his beak on. But the cuttlefish in the water changes colors and does some incredible stuff. Have you seen that happen?
Yeah, of course. It's I do not possess the lexicon. I'm just talking just straight away. I do not possess the words to describe watching these creatures, whether it's related to the octopus family. It is like watching a movie. It just doesn't feel real, but you know it is. But you just can't believe what you're seeing because it's so animated. But these animals just simply immediately take on the exact color and texture of the background they're on. Same thing goes for the peacock flounder. In fact, at MIT University in the United States, They took a chessboard, black and white squares, and they put it down, and an octopus went on it, and it just, the octopus took on the squares of the check of the chessboard.
Oh, wow.
It's beyond, I'm feeling chills as I'm describing this, but take me very seriously. There are fabulous films where you could see it on YouTube and see an octopus simply getting onto a reef and suddenly blending in. It is Marabu Mahasecha Hashem. All your works praise you. Of course, I've seen this hundreds of times where the octopus just changes colors to, there's nothing subtle about it, bright oranges to dull blooms to yellows and just lights. It's not, there's no subtlety. Because remember, the octopus's life depends on it in the sense that, or its eating habits depend on it. So it's immediately, as soon as it touches it, within seconds, it changes huge colors like it had electric bulbs and someone was pulling switches. Nothing short of that.
That's amazing. That is incredible. That's absolutely amazing. Isn't our God amazing in his creation?
Did you guys get certified, man? I mean, come on, let's go. Okay.
I haven't done it yet, but I'm really...
What is it with the snorkel?
I don't know. Look, when I go, like, I don't mind getting into the snow. I don't mind getting into the surf and surfing and whatnot. But if I put on a pair of goggles and look underwater in the sea, all of a sudden I'm overwhelmed by the vastness of what I cannot see. Now, when you're above the water, it never occurs to me to be concerned about what is underneath. But once I look underneath and I can look around and I realize that my vision is only... can only extend so far, all of a sudden I feel vulnerable. If I bring my head up out of the water, I can see all the way to the horizon, and for some reason I feel okay with that. What's with that?
That's so deep, Jono.
Thank you.
Really, that works on so many levels. But we won't go there today.
I could share something really quite fascinating with you, if you'd like. And that's with regard to the Red Sea. The Red Sea, ordinarily you just get certified and then you're able to dive anywhere in the world. It's a license that never expires. But to dive in the Red Sea, you have to show 50 log dives within the last year. And the reason is it's wall diving. That means that the Red Sea just drops. It's a drift dive and there's no floor. You don't see any floor. You talk about being disoriented. You have to use the wall and your computer as your orientation. So you're looking at the wall.
Listeners, did you hear that he said, and your computer? Now he's taking not only incredible photography equipment down, he's got a computer as well.
Yeah, the computer is calculating how much air you have. It's calculating what it thinks, how much air you have left, how deep you are, the temperature of the water. It's got an electric compass in it. That it's got everything. So it tells you everything you need to know. Some of them actually have in them video games in case you just get bored. I'm not kidding. stop laughing. I'm kidding. What happens is the very deep dives. It's so weird. But you have to do what's called a decompression dive, which I don't do. I only do non-deep. But you have to do all these stops along the way and wait there for a half hour to work off all the nitrogen. So you're sitting there on a rope doing nothing at some ridiculous depth. So they actually have video games so you can just sit there and run it around. I can't believe this. It's true. Okay. And he goes, I want one now. I don't need the wood. I'll just want to play with the video game. The Red Sea is an enormous trench, very, very deep. It drops thousands of feet down, 6,000, 8,000. In essence, when you're diving, you can't see the bottom. You're only orienting yourself through the wall. The key question was, we're going back to the Bible. Some 3,328 years ago, Scripture tells us the Jewish people crossed this sea. The problem is there would be nowhere to cross, meaning it's a cliff. It all just drops straight down. It's a wall. So if you remove the water, let's say you part the water, you can't walk off. It'd be like walking off the tallest building in the world, much higher. You just would fall down thousands of that. You'd fall down miles.
Miles.
Just you. I mean, if it's 10,000 feet, you just fall, and it's a straight sheer drop. So the question is, where could the Jews have crossed? There's only one place, and listen like you've never listened in your life. If you're standing, sit down. There's only one place, and we all who've taken boats across the Red Sea know exactly where it is. It's a one very shallow area of the Red Sea. It just never dips lower than about 200 feet or so. And it goes nice down, and then it comes right up the North African continent. The only place this is possible. When you're on a boat, everything has to be tied down, because you imagine the water comes in and smashes into this beautiful little place. And that's the only place where people could just walk gently down, walk to the other side, and then come back up. Well, going back about a decade ago, folks said, well, if this is the only place that the Jewish people could have crossed, let's send down diving equipment, let's send down the cameras. We want to find, is there any relic of the of this epic event in human history? Sure enough, and I'm feeling chills as I'm telling you this, you can Google this search. They found there chariot wheels and chariot parts, Egyptian chariot parts, strewn throughout this very unique only area of the Red Sea. They're not chariot parts being in a ship. They're Egyptian chariots, wheels, spokes, the whole thing, laying there in the ground, obviously with enormous crustacean of coral that's formed around it, right there. And and they date it back to about 3,000 years. And you can go on Google Images, Egyptian chariots, Red Sea, and bang, it's right there for you to see. It's the only place that any people could have crossed. No other place would have allowed it. Any other place you would have walked off the edge, you'd drop down thousands of feet.
I know, that's amazing. Awesome. That is incredible, isn't it?
Isn't that crazy? Isn't that like wow? Like you just wow, but it's right there. So God bless. So they went deeper than I would have gone. They went down. Fantastic equipment, but the Egyptian chariot wheels are there, just strewn right on that area. We've mapped the whole Red Sea, obviously. Everything else is thousands and thousands of feet down, and it's a straight wall drop. Only there do you have that nice little path to walk across.
That's amazing, and that's of course Exodus chapter 14, verse 25. And he took off their chariot wheels so that they drove them with difficulty, and the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians." And that's what he's saying, that the archaeological evidence is there.
Yeah, there's so much going on because you think of Iran. You know, Ezekiel tells us that God will harden the heart of the enemies of Israel. Mm-hmm. You look at them like, what are they thinking, going to war against Israel? And you ask yourself, 11 months of 10 plagues in Egypt, what was Pharaoh thinking of going after the Jews? You think he would have enough. Exodus 4:27, and God hardened Pharaoh's heart. Mm-hmm. That's what he's doing right now in Persia. His hand now is upon the land of Israel and the world. His focus on that part of the world.
Mm. Amen. So, listen, I think there's so many photos that I would love to ask you about, but we're running short of time now, and I really wanted to talk about, at some stage, we might have to come back and do this if you're willing, to talk about Ezekiel chapter 47, verses 7 to 10. There's a little homework for the listeners. They can read up on that. And would you be willing to come back and talk about that with us?
Of course. That's the end. It's not the end of Ezekiel. It's one more chapter. That's the completion of the size of Israel, Jerusalem, and the third temple. Fabulous text. Marches right through and thunders. It's all awe-inspiring. Very, very special. I look forward to that.
It's amazing, and it talks about that the waters will be healed, and I think, but let's not get into it in detail now, but I think it's talking about the Dead Sea, that the waters will be healed, and it shall be that every living thing that moves, wherever the rivers go, it will live. There will be a great multitude of fish, because these waters go there, for they shall be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes, and it shall be that scuba divers will dive there, and fishermen will stand there from En Gedi to En Eglaim, and they will... And it goes on and on and on. It sounds very exciting. I'd love to talk about that with you again soon. Rabbi Tobias Singer, my friend, thank you so much for coming on to Truth to You for the first time.
Well, it was an honor joining you here on here. Get yourself certified right now, both of you. And it was a joy to discuss Hashem's wonders with you on here. Thank you and shalom.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you, Mr. Spiritual Babies, for joining us. Until next time, dear listeners, be blessed and be set apart by the truth of our Father's word. Shalom.